Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is net zero, energy and transport. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question both to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, but to also make sure that they cut out any lengthy preambles and limit themselves to a question, and then a plea then for the responses to be similarly brief. And I call question number one, Richard Leonard. We have Mr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I remind members of my voluntary register of interests to ask the Scottish Government what steps it has taken to implement Scotland's National Transport Strategy?
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The National Transport Strategy was developed collaboratively with partners, and it underpins all decision making related to transport, with the Regional Transport Partnership developing strategies for their area to align with it. Delivering its vision is a shared endeavour with responsibilities across the Scottish Government, operators, local authorities, business, industry and users, and I co-chair the National Transport Strategy Delivery Board alongside COSLA, which includes members from partner organisations. Last December, we published a report to Parliament outlining steps we have taken to deliver the strategy alongside our third delivery plan for 2023-2024. The fourth plan will be published later this year.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply? The Scottish Government's National Transport Strategy is based on four priorities: reducing inequality, taking action on climate change, delivering economic growth, and improving health and well-being. Scrapping peak fares on ScotRail has driven a shift from road to rail. 4 million extra train journeys have been made, 2 million of them because people have been incentivised to leave their cars at home. So doesn't the Cabinet Secretary understand why people are angry about her announcement that it will force up some rail fares by 48%? Doesn't she accept that it fails on every single one of her own government's four national transport strategy tests? So will she do the right thing while there is still time and reverse this disastrous decision?
Cabinet Secretary.
So can I address the member directly? There are a number of questions presented, officer, in this area. I think he's quite correct to identify that the Scottish Government's national missions include tackling child poverty and tackling the climate emergency. So when I say in terms of the measure and modal shift that the peak fares trial unfortunately failed at that point, 0.1% of car journeys were transferred to rail. And when, can I also say to the member that the discount that has existed over the last year has seen many existing rail users benefit from hundreds, if not thousands, of pounds during that year. But the assessment, I encourage him to read it, the assessment shows that the majority of those that benefited were those from middle to high incomes. So from on those two measures alone, the actual report identifies that his analysis is incorrect. And finally, can I say, Presiding Officer, with the discounts that are being provided, Falkirk to Edinburgh with a flexi pass will be £13.40 return for five returns, compared to an off-peak fare currently of £12.10. And also for annual, if you're doing it 4 days a week, it would be £10.04. That's a reduction. So if you listen to what I've said, if you're prepared to promote the discounts that are being announced now for the coming year and beyond, actually some people will be similar to what they are with the peak fare trial removal if he looks at the figures.
Okay, that's not an auspicious start on the back of my request for brevity. Bill Kidd, let's see if we can do any better.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll sit down. No. Now that more than 150 million free bus journeys have been made by children and young people in Scotland since the introduction of free bus travel for under 22s, can the Cabinet Secretary set out how this Scottish Government initiative is working towards the vision and priorities of the National Transport Strategy?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
1 year on, the evaluation of the scheme showed that by making bus travel more accessible, the scheme is already opening doors to new opportunities and reducing travel costs for families across Scotland. By making sustainable travel easier and cheaper for Scotland's children and young people, this transformational policy is giving them the very best chance to succeed in life, as well as supporting them to play their part in cutting emissions and taking climate action in line with the vision of the National Transport Strategy.
Graham Simpson.
The reintroduction of peak fares on the railways is going to see huge increases across the country. If I want to get a return from East Kilbride to Glasgow, it's going to cost me 55% more. East Kilbride to Edinburgh and back will be 84% more. So how does this fit in with the Scottish Government's ambition to cut car journeys by a fifth by next year?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think in terms of his latter point, I think, is an incorrect assessment of what the plans are, but in relation to car reduction. But in relation to his travel, I would also ask him, as he obviously is a regular commuter by train, that he can use a FlexiPass, which is going to have a permanent 20% reduction. He can use an annual season ticket, which will have a 20% reduction. And in the figures that I have set out, there will be a situation where actually with those discounts that are being put forward just now, people will be able to have reduced fares, in many cases similar to the off-peak fare. And I'm delighted, I will send him the East Kilbride figures so he can promote them to his constituents in the wider central region to promote the discounts that will be available for regular commuters as he is going forward.
Question 2, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of its position on the reintroduction of peak fares on ScotRail trains.
Cabinet Secretary.
All MSPs and the public can read the report evaluating the peak fares removal trial on Transport Scotland's website. I would encourage them to do so. While there was a limited increase in the number of passengers during the year, it did not achieve one of the key aims of encouraging a significant modal shift from car to rail. It mainly benefited those who already used rail, saving them hundreds if not thousands of pounds through subsidised discounted fares. And although some lower income passengers benefited, it was middle to higher income passengers who mostly benefited. Given the financial challenges we face, the significant additional subsidy required to continue the pilot versus its limited contribution towards government missions of tackling climate change and tackling child poverty means that the pilot will end on the 27th of September. And to mitigate the impact, we are reducing the costs of season tickets by 20% and flexi-passes. And, Presiding Officer, I would encourage all members to promote that.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer? She clearly doesn't understand the economic argument. For someone who lives in Edinburgh going to Glasgow, it will go from £16.20 to £31.40. That will simply force more people into their cars. Can she explain further, was a proper economic and environmental study carried out? And if so, will this be debated in Parliament before this final decision is made?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the decision has been made. It was always a trial. In fact, we extended the trial not just once, but twice. I was keen to see it succeed, and that's why it was extended until September. But I can give you an example with the promotions I've already outlined in Parliament. A Glasgow-Edinburgh return currently is £16.20 all day. With the offer that has just been announced for 20% savings on season tickets, it would be the equivalent of £14.82 per day for an annual season ticket holder if they're travelling 5 days a week. For those using a FlexiPass, that same return journey Edinburgh to Glasgow would cost £21.25. So those discounts going forward from September will offset the situation that we have currently between peak and off-peak fares. And I think a £16.20 off-peak fare is very attractive compared to the figures that have been cited today.
OK, I'm going to try and take a further couple of supplementaries, but they'll need to be brief, as will the responses. First, George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, my constituents are interested in the actual cost of their commute. So can the Cabinet Secretary please set out what savings are available to the average commuter from Paisley using popular routes?
Cabinet Secretary.
those specific savings available will be individual to the commuter and the route they commute on. With the 20% discount on season passes for those commuting to work more frequently, it means that per journey equivalent fare is in some cases lower than the off-peak fare and in all cases cheaper than them paying for any time day return tickets. Alternatively, flexi passes offer savings for those who don't commute regularly or frequently. Flexi passes 10 tickets over a 2-month period. For the Paisley, Gilmer Street and Glasgow route, who currently enjoy a £4.90 all-day fare, that would be the equivalent of £3.25 per day if they travelled 5 days a week, choosing an annual season ticket. Or for those who travel less regularly and would prefer a flexi pass, a daily fare would equal £4.85, and that's compared to the peak fare of £7.20.
Thank you, Mark Ruskell.
I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will reflect on the deep disappointment of thousands and thousands of people across Scotland at the return of peak fares. Clearly, scrapping peak fares led to an increase in passengers, around 7%, and more income for ScotRail. So if bringing back peak fares results in passengers now abandoning trains, that's going to be less money, less income for ScotRail. If that happens, will the Cabinet Secretary consider reversing the position?
Cabinet Secretary.
I've already said that I was personally disappointed that there wasn't a successful evaluation reported. The 6.8% increase in use was actually at the maximum level. Some of the lower levels of assessment was actually only just less than 3%. And unfortunately, the increase in journeys was at the beginning of the pilot. It latterly tailed off. I might add that the assessment was made around about the beginning of July, so it doesn't include the disruptive period. However, I have also said that should the UK government start to invest more in public services, and we have a consequence of that, that I am open to reconsider the position.
Question 3, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will review its goal of decarbonising Scotland's transport in light of its reported decisions to increase fares and cut services on Scotland's railways.
Cabinet Secretary.
So we continue to decarbonise our transport with additional funding to support Scotland's EV charging network, to support confident switching to electric cars. We're on target to provide 6,000 EV chargers by 2026. On rail, we recently electrified the Barrhead line. We're electrifying the East Kilbride line with the provision of a travel interchange. And only yesterday, I announced approval for procurement of a replacement train fleet for our intercity services. And we've just announced funding of £41.7 million for 252 low-emission buses. Unfortunately, the peak fare removal trial was unsuccessful, with just 0.1% of car journeys moved to rail. I'm hopeful that the current temporary timetable will return to full timetabling shortly, and I'm pleased that rail unions are recommending to their members an acceptance of the latest pay offer from ScotRail. And I've taken steps, as you've heard, to introduce discounts on annual season tickets of 20% and permanently on flexi passes for 20% reduction as well.
Mark Griffin.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. But, Presiding Officer, transport in Scotland is now Scotland's biggest emitter of CO2, yet rail passengers face a double whammy of fare hikes and cuts to more than 530 train services each day compared to 2019. The UK Climate Commission have accused the Scottish Government of having no plan to reduce car kilometres, and the Government itself undermined that peak service trial with cuts to services and a lack of advertising. Now, does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the Government has dismantled travellers' ability to make greener transport choices, is driving up costs on the railways, driving down services, and has seemingly abandoned its own goal of decarbonising our transport system?
Cabinet Secretary.
I completely reject that analysis. I've talked about the increase in electric chargers. We have the most comprehensive electric charging system outside London, and that is encouraging people to switch to electric vehicles. I would also point out that if you want to try and tackle change from car use, actually investing in buses is probably, in terms of our preference, we have limited choices. Do we invest in rail, where the impact, as we know from the evaluation, is for more middle to upper income passengers and isn't encouraging more switching from car to rail, actually looking at other modes might be a better use of public funding. I still am committed to try and ensure we can make rail more attractive to more people, but 75% of passenger journeys already on rail are on electrified lines. We're improving what we're doing in terms of buses and supporting the bus fleet. That is a strong argument on decarbonisation. I'm very pleased to see that. I recently met with the Climate Change Committee myself and discussed our proposals, and they also know that we're proposing... And
thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We are going to have briefer responses. Brief supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's not just railways that need decarbonising. Ageing ferries are Shetland's biggest carbon emitters and many need to be replaced. Will the Scottish Government outline its policy on short subsea tunnels for Shetland, as such a project would be a contributor to the Scottish Government's goal of decarbonising transport?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the member will know it's the Cabinet Secretary for Finance with our local government responsibilities that are working with the Shetland Ferry Task Force. I am open to work on ferries, I think, in terms of ferries, but also in terms of tunnels. I think in terms of that big infrastructure spend that would be required, it needs innovation. I also think it needs independence. If we're going to do big infrastructure projects like subsea tunnels, having the capability as a state, as Faroe relies on the Danish state to underwrite their tunnels, that actually is a positive argument for changing how we can fund our public services.
And briefly, Evelyn Tweed.
They offer examples of achievements regarding the decarbonisation of Scotland's railway under the SNP and give an indication of what the impact the new intercity fleet is anticipated to have in this regard.
As briefly as possible, Cabinet.
A new intercity fleet has a requirement to reduce emissions. The member will know for my own constituency, the Stirling Dublin Alloa line has been electrified. We know about Edinburgh Glasgow. And as I've already indicated, the Barhead line was completed very recently and we're working on the East Kilbride line.
Question 4, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with Network Rail and ScotRail regarding them improving the Dumfries to Glasgow train service.
Cabinet Secretary.
Transport Scotland officials meet regularly with ScotRail and Network Rail Scotland to discuss rail services. Train services in Dumfries and Galloway have been improved through ScotRail's previous timetable changes, which resulted in a consistent hourly service between Dumfries and Carlisle and a two-hourly service between Dumfries and Glasgow. Like many other routes, the Dumfries to Glasgow service has been affected by the current ScotRail reduced temporary timetable. I am hopeful that there will be a return of normal services and I am keen for that to happen as soon as possible.
Emma Harper.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The Dumfries to Glasgow rail service is a vital link which connects communities in the south to Scotland's cities. Constituents report that the service is slow and that the fleet servicing the line is dated. And we've heard that if the journey time is faster, such as by electrification, that Dumfries and other areas of D&G could become commuter towns for Glasgow, helping to address depopulation. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore agree to meet with me to discuss how we can improve this important line?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to decarbonising its passenger rail network. That's set out in our decarbonisation plan, which is a dynamic document. It's due for a refresh and it's underway, and we'll examine how decarbonisation can best be achieved. The plan commits to all passenger diesel trains being replaced. And the order and programme in which that is done will depend on business cases and available budgets. Although there's no timeline for electrification of the line from Glasgow to Dumfries and it's yet to be confirmed, I'm happy to meet with the member to discuss this important matter in more detail.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Finlay Carson.
It's not surprising that Emma Harper didn't mention the 80% fare hike from Dumfries to Glasgow, which will rise from £24 to £43. The RMT have highlighted the flawed evaluation process, with the first survey being carried out in December, when there are fewer commuters, and the second survey carried out in July, when many commuters in Scotland are on holiday. So how can the Cabinet Secretary justify the decision to scrap the trials, which will now result in exorbitant fare increases for hard-pressed rural commuters?
Cabinet Secretary is relevant to the question.
Well, I will send the member more detail in terms of the season tickets reduction for Carlisle and Dumfries, but can I tell them they will pay £8.91 for a return journey if they use the season ticket 5 days a week. On flexi passes and a discount, it would be £15.95. But can I say to the member that in terms of the evaluation, December actually is a busy time for the trains, and it was actually in terms of that period that is a busy time. We had wanted to do the evaluation not at the beginning of or in the July period, but because of the Conservative government calling the election, we were asked, because it was a popular policy, that we weren't able to do the research during that period, and we had to postpone it from the earlier June period to July. That's a matter of fact, whether he likes it or not. I didn't like it, he doesn't like it, but that's a matter of fact.
And Colin Smith, briefly.
Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why commuters on that Dumfries to Glasgow Nithfire line are facing the largest hikes in rail fares when peak fares are reintroduced? A peak time return from Dumfries to Carlisle will increase from £7.60 to £23.50. That's 211%. Nowhere else in Scotland faces such big differences between a peak and off-peak fare than we're going to have from Dumfries station. So why in this utterly illogical way ScotRail fares
Cabinet Secretary,
are
Cabinet Secretary.
Discriminated against?
So I'm perfectly happy to ask ScotRail to provide an explanation to Colin Smith directly. However, he makes a very important point about anomalies between fares and fare miles. One of the things we did in taking rail into public ownership was require ScotRail and Scottish Rail Holdings to provide a system by which we can have a fairer system of fares, and that's due to report to me next year. It doesn't address the point that the member makes as of now, but I will specifically take up that point with ScotRail.
OK, we're 20 minutes in. We're only halfway through the questions. The questions are going to have to be briefer as are the responses. Question 5, Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to assist local authorities with repairing potholes in light of the reports of the detrimental impact that large numbers of potholes are having on drivers across Scotland.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much appreciate the road maintenance challenges and the importance of a safe, well-performing road network, and I certainly do not minimise the importance of the point that the member is raising. However, local road maintenance is the responsibility of the local authorities, who allocate resources based on their local priorities. The 2024-25 local government settlement increased local authorities' share of the budget and delivered a record funding of over £14 billion. That's a real terms increase of 2.5%. And the Independent Accounts Commission confirmed this follows real terms increases in both 2022-23 and 2023-24. So it's for locally elected representatives to decide how best to deliver those services to their communities, and the Scottish Government has increased the maintenance budget for the trunk road network for which it is responsible.
Pam Gosell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The number of potholes recorded by local authorities is on the rise, with 2,463 recorded in East Dumbartonshire alone. Years of brutal funding cuts means our local authorities lack the resources to afford essential road repairs. And we know the Scottish Government is set to make damaging cuts to the upcoming budget. So how does the Scottish Government intend to address the many worries of drivers who pay high prices for damage caused by potholes that fear this issue may never be fixed?
Yeah. Minister.
In order for brevity, I will repeat the point that I've just made, that these are local authority decisions. The Government has increased the amount of money that has gone to local authorities, and the local authorities will prioritise their spend.
Question 6, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to improve road safety on the A75.
The Scottish Government is committed to improving safety on our trunk roads, including the A75. Since 2007, over £152 million has been invested on the A75 to ensure its safe and efficient operation. We are progressing a number of actions to further improve safety on the A75. These actions involve a speed management scheme at the A75 at Crocketford, introducing signalisation at Cuckoo Bridge, roundabout and junction improvements at A75 Hawk of Ayr. Our annual assessment of trunk road safety performance has identified section of the A75 by Rosewald, Glenluce and Twyneholme for further investigation this financial year.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and for mentioning Musseld. I'd like the whole road to be duelled, but clearly under the SNP that's not going to happen. So will she take away and look at the very reasonable request from some deeply concerned and desperate constituents at Musseld to introduce a couple of double white lines to prevent dangerous overtaking and potentially save lives at that location?
OK, Cabinet Secretary.
So I will undertake to look at that. I can tell him that Transport Scotland has incorporated the Musselt Junction into the investigation on the A75 from just west of Breckenridge to east of Craigiebank, which is scheduled to be undertaken in 25-26.
Question 7, Hamza Youssef.
The Scottish Government, what its priorities are for COP29, which will take place in Baku later this year.
Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland is committed to playing our part at COPs, working with international partners to secure a global transition to a net zero and resilient future in a way that is fair and just for all. While our COP29 plans are still being developed, we anticipate these to focus on driving international action on equitable and transparent climate finance, using our leadership of Regions 4 and the Under 2 Coalition to build climate ambition and action, showcasing our own net zero journey and playing our part as good global citizens to advance international relations. As usual, at COPs across all these aims, Scotland will continue to play a bridging role, ensuring the voices of women, young people and the Global South are heard at COP29.
Come to you, sir.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that very comprehensive response. Scotland can rightly pride itself on being a pioneer of the Loss and Damage Fund by becoming, of course, the first country in the Global North to commit funds towards loss and damage at COP26. And by doing so, that of course, it recognises that those in the Global South are disproportionately impacted by the climate crisis. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that if the fight against climate injustice is to be meaningfully continued, then the loss and damage funds that were committed to at COP28 last year must be distributed not just as quickly as possible to those communities that are ravaged by the climate crisis, but done in a way that does not further the debt burden on those countries in the Global South?
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely do agree with Mr Youssef on that. Under our climate justice approach, the Scottish Government recognises our moral responsibility to support vulnerable communities in the Global South to address climate-induced loss and damage. And it's these communities least responsible for the global climate crisis that are often more severely affected by it. Scotland welcomed the agreement at COP28 on operationally the UNFCCC Loss and Damage Fund. I want to recognise the fundamental role that Hamza Youssef played in that and the leadership that he's shown on loss and damage. This fund must be urgently mobilised to ensure rapid and equitable access to sufficient funding. It's crucial that a portion of the fund is ring-fenced to provide finance directly to communities in the forms of grants, not loans. The urgency of the climate crisis and the disproportional impact that demands that we act now.
I'm going to take a couple of brief supplementaries. First, Sarah Boyack.
Given the sustained failure of the Scottish Government to meet our climate targets, wouldn't demonstrating how we could actually reduce our homes, buildings, transport and land emissions be a fundamental contribution that we could make if we're to have credibility at COP29?
Cabinet Secretary.
Sarah Boyack will get no disagreement from me, apart from the first point of what she said. We are demonstrating our credibility by the programme for government was announced yesterday, which set out some actions that have been taken in that. We have had repeated actions, not just in this portfolio, but across many portfolios, including that of the Transport Cabinet Secretary that's beside me, and on land use as well. Obviously, a climate change bill has been brought to Parliament, but there is also a heat and buildings bill that has been put forward in the programme for government as well.
And briefly, Douglas Lumsden.
Presiding Officer, does the Cabinet Secretary think the SNP Government can go to COP29 with a single ounce of credibility now that the Government has ditched its climate change targets and this week diverted £460 million of ScotWind cash away from the climate emergency and towards filling the SNP budget black hole?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Lumsden won't be surprised to hear that I do not agree with that in the slightest. We have already halved our emissions. We have plans to do an awful lot more. We're bringing forward our new climate change bill, which will mean that we have a credible plan towards 2045, as we always have. This is a high priority of the First Minister and his government. And it's not just my portfolio that it's threaded through. It's every single portfolio in government. And the action that needs to be taken will be taken across the board.
Question 8, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the duelling of the A9.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government is progressing with the A9 Julian delivery plan set out in December 2023 to Parliament. The Tamatan Tamoy section will see work starting in the coming months following award in July. This will be the start of continuous work on A9 Julian until the programme is completed. I announced the three shortlisted bidders for the next section, Tay Crossing to Ballinuig, in August. And once these two latest sections are completed by the end of 2028, that will see 45% of the A9 between Perth and Inverness Dual.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The SNP's failure to duel the A9 is a complete betrayal of the people of Scotland. Between January 2020 and December 23, non-duelled sections of the A9 accounted for 90% of fatal incidents. This is a travesty solely at the hands of the SNP. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept this, and what guarantees are being given that the duelling of the A9 will be completed by 2035 at the latest?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can give that commitment because it's set out in our December plan that we reported to Parliament. I am conscious of the issues around fatalities. Obviously, there have been different levels of fatalities in different years. However, it's really important that we recognise that the work that we are doing is already seeing those contracts being let. We see the work commencing, and as I said, there will be continuous work on the A9 until it's completed in 2035, and as I said, 45% of that will be done by 2028.
And brief supplementary, Fergus Hugh.
Bringing forward the completion date for duelling of the A9, which presently is 2035. May I ask the Cabinet Secretary what progress is being made on that plea and consideration thereof? And secondly, will she bring an oral statement back to Parliament to provide a full update about such progress for a swifter completion?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I'm afraid I missed the beginning of the member's contribution, but I know because he and others met with myself and the First Minister about the issue of the A9 and duelling. I undertake, as the First Minister did, to keep the programme under review to identify whether there is any way to make any progress in terms of speed. And I think the issue that the members made at that time was the ordering. Now, obviously, we've got to balance market capacity impacts on road users as well as the challenging financial constraints. So on the basis that the committee will have the regular updates for the A9 as we have promised, looking at the acceleration would require careful consideration, not immediate consideration, but I do undertake to keep the member and indeed Parliament informed of any progress in keeping that under review.
Thank you, and apologies to those I wasn't able to call. As you will see, we have overrun quite a bit, but we now need to move on to the next item of business. There'll be a brief pause to allow front benches to change.